Off the Record with Rush.
Rush, Off the Record with Mary Turner, brought to you by Budweiser. For all you do, this Bud's for you. And the U.S. Navy. Navy, it's not just a job, it's an adventure. Rush, Off the Record.
We play the music and people like it, they buy our records, you know. That's the kind of equation it's supposed to be. Not, well, if we spend $3 million on advertising, then I predict that 500,000 people will buy this record and we can get it up to number 14 in Billboard. Everything got to be so charted that the business actually thought they controlled it, and it's not true. It's always in the hands of the musicians first and the audience second. Those are the people that really control where music goes. They don't realize it a lot of times, but they really say no or yes.
Rush, three guys from Canada who started as a local Toronto favorite and have become an international success. Hi, I'm Mary Turner with drummer Neil Peart and singer Geddy Lee. We'll be talking about the band's success and what they attribute it all to. Their music, their audience, and their refusal to compromise.
Did you always want to be in a rock and roll band?
Well, not always, no. I think first I wanted to be an atomic scientist, I think when I was a little kid. And I probably wanted to be a baseball player or something, but in recent memory, I wanted to play in a band, yeah.
Is there any truth to this rumor that your parents were very disappointed when you decided that this was going to be your career rather than something that...
Of course.
Yes.
Parents don't want you to play rock music. They want you to be something real. They want you to be like a doctor or a lawyer or something.
Of course. Have they come around? Have they changed?
Oh, yeah. Oh, yeah. My mother came around as soon as she saw me on television. She thought, well, it's a nice way to make a living.
So yeah.
Made sense to her then.
After a couple of years of playing the high schools and bars around Toronto, Rush released their first album on their own label, Moon Records. Right after that, John Rutsey, the group's original drummer, left. Geddy and guitarist Alex Lifeson set up auditions to find a new one, and Neil Peart turned up and knocked them out with his playing. Geddy remembered that when Neil first joined, they had no idea he would soon be the group's main lyric writer.
He was just a drummer, a great drummer, we thought, okay. We got on the road, and it was really weird because we only had a week before our first tour. It was like, get a drummer, rehearse the material, and go. Because, you know, we finally had a chance to tour the United States and open for people like Uriah Heep, who were very big at the time, and Manfred Mann and Rory Gallagher. And so it was really exciting, but we had very little time to prepare, so, and we didn't really even know each other. And, you know, we started doing shows in front of 15,000 people, opening up, you know. It was a whole new world, and we didn't know really if Neil could write. We didn't even think of it, really. And as we got to know each other on the tour, we noticed that he read a lot of books. I thought, oh, this guy's smart. He reads books. He can talk. Maybe he can write. Because lyric writing is always an aspect that, you know, we sort of dreaded doing. It was like, oh, okay, you write the lyrics, all right. So we figured, hey, maybe this guy can do it. So we suggested it to him, and he said he'll try it, and he's done very well at it.
Yes, he certainly has. Yeah. Did it change your sound of the songs that you write? It must have. Somewhere.
Well, at first, it was very different to have someone who could write lyrics that had some weight and really were interesting. It was other than just simple rock and roll type lyrics that you throw together. But it seemed to fit, because the music that we wanted to write, the music we were starting to write, you know, required something a little out of the ordinary, I guess, from a lyrical point of view. So it all sort of fit in. It was like, I don't know, it was more of a, we found the third member. It was really an equal thing.
In the very beginning, you certainly weren't getting a whole lot of help from critics or radio stations either, but still you managed to build up a big audience pretty fast. How'd you manage to do this city-by-city takeover?
One by one, they just sort of started to click in our favor. We just toured and toured, and there was lots of people that we were opening for all the time, and just work as hard as we could. We'd get out and we'd play for so many. We'd open for anybody who'd have us, basically. You know, you need an opening act, we're here, we'll play. And we just kept touring, and one by one, the cities in the Midwest came around to us, and eventually it spread out now to, you know, everywhere. So
the world.
Yeah.
If you had to name a turning point in your career, or a time, would it be 2112?
Oh, yeah.
I think so.
That's really our first record. First real record, mm-hmm. I think. You know, the other records were records, but that was really basic stuff, you know. It was really groping in the dark. With 2112, I think we achieved the beginning of a real sound that we could call ours anyway.
For Neil Peart, performing live is the only way to become a better musician. Neil and Getty talk about touring and Rush's constant efforts to be a little different from the next group, off the record. Neil, it seems like you've been spending a lot of your time on the road. Do you still enjoy touring? Is it still fun for you?
Oh, obviously, yeah. I mean, we wouldn't do it if it wasn't a matter of choice. We still feel that we're very much in control of ourselves. So we just decide what we want to accomplish this year. And fit in time off at the optimum times around that. Like, we like to be home in the summertime, we like to be home around Christmas time. So you figure all that out, and you want to record an album. But being on the road is probably a prime function. It's the thing that we spend the most time at, and as musicians, it's the best thing for you to be playing a lot, playing really hard, because we do a long show, so it is tremendously demanding and challenging. So that can only be good. I mean, it's forcing you to get better all the time, and as the show or parts of the show become simple because of repetition, then you're forced to make them more difficult just to keep your interest high. So consequently, it pushes you as a musician into more difficult areas. That's a very positive thing, touring. And also just the traveling part of it, aside from music, is very, what would you say, like travel broadens one in the cliche sense. It's very true. It keeps us firmly rooted in reality, and it keeps, I know for myself as a lyricist, it keeps me open to a lot of new ideas and new influences and new images and things that I'm constantly becoming aware of.
All right, would you please welcome home Rush!
There comes a time in every tour where I want to leave and run away, because when the novelty of the tour wears off, you know, about three quarters of the way through, when it wears off, it's a grind, and you face facts, you're working hard every day to play well, you know. But I do generally like the lifestyle.
I bet you it's very physically grueling, just even if you didn't have to do all the traveling every day. Just, I mean, that's a lot of sweat you put out there.
Yeah, well, it's emotionally draining, it's mentally draining, it's physically draining, so it does take its toll on you. At the end of a show, you're tired. No bones about it, you're tired. So, but you just learn how to live on the road so that you can keep up with that. You pace yourself, you know, so you're not burning yourself out every night. So by the middle of the tour, you're dead. You know, it's all careful training.
The song YYZ, or YYZ, I guess you'd say, in Canadian. This is a song that you wrote for an airport?
YYZ is the Morse code tag for Toronto International Airport. You know, like LA is LAX. And whenever your bags go to a city, they have these three strange letters on the baggage tag, which is the code word for all the international spies that are moving your luggage around under the airport. So YYZ is, I mean, we've come home many times and left from Toronto International Airport many, many times. So it's an important place in our lives, you know, so.
So you're always glad to get home, huh?
Oh, yeah.
It seems like you made a conscious effort from the very beginning to not be another regular rock and roll band.
Well, I mean, what is a regular rock and roll band?
Well, to me, it's, I mean, you know, a lot of rock and roll songs deal with the same stuff. Sex, drugs, rock and roll, cars, yeah. That kind of stuff. I mean, you guys are some pretty cerebral rock.
Well, I mean, we just figured, hey, there's enough people doing that, so who needs another one doing it? We were inclined to write things that about things that were a little, you know, different from your normal rock and roll stuff. And there's like thousands of bands doing that anyway, so, you know, let's try something a little different, yeah. So it was a conscious effort.
There is unrest in the forest. There is trouble with the trees. For the maples want more sunlight and the oaks ignore their pleas.
Critics have called Rush a band without an image. When we come back, Geddy Lee talks about that and the new Rush improvement plan.
Neil, you guys have been working at an unbelievably hectic pace since 1974. Do you feel pressured into all this touring and recording that you do?
Oh, it's not external pressure, put it that way. And we don't take orders from anyone, so the pressure that we exert on ourselves is chosen. You know, we feel that it's good to work under pressure, it's good to work hard, because the results are that much better, and the results are where the satisfaction comes from. The only real reward we get is at whatever stage in the song, all of a sudden you go, that's good. And whether it's you've just written the song and you're listening back to a rough recording, there's a certain buzz that comes either there or after the song is recorded. You sit back and go, yes, you know, that's the moment of happiness. So you realize that that is accentuated by the amount of work that you put into it, because it makes it that much better. Something else, it's also an end. You know, the big dream for most musicians, I think, is just to be able to work. You know, not to achieve success, but most musicians who are really serious about it, to them the end is work, the kind of work that we have where we choose where we play and under what conditions we play, we choose when we want to make an album, where and how we want to make that album. And those things, that independence, I think, is the goal.
You have said we are not an image band, which I think may be one reason that the press has been less than kind to you.
Well, we're not an image band. I mean, I don't know. I guess just saying that makes us an image band. Our image is the lack of image. But I don't know. We're not a lifestyle band. We don't put too much value on what we eat for breakfast, or our faces aren't that important to us. You know, we're taking a break from our face, to coin a phrase. You know, I just don't think it's that important. The important thing has always been our music, so let's put the emphasis on that, you know. What we do after the show, or who we hang around with, or what kind of hairstyles we have, or whatever. That's just not important.
On the new album, there are a lot more, for want of a better word, accessible songs. Mm-hmm. They're sort of compressed. Was that by design? Sort of paring down.
Well, it's all part of the great improvement plan, you know. I mean, it's all well and good to write 20-minute pieces, and we do enjoy doing that, and we still might do that in the future. But it came to a point where the longer pieces, we were just doing for the sake of doing them, and it was getting ridiculous because, you know, you can't stand still. You can't. I mean, for us to write, at one point, it was like for us to write another 10-minute or 20-minute song was to write the same song over again, just using different notes. It was like, how many different versions of the same song can you write? So it was time to go on to new areas. It was time to say, okay, let's not think in those terms right now. Let's think in terms of melody, or in terms of writing a good song, you know. Let's try to take what we've learned and what we can do in 20 minutes and try to take the most important aspects of that and put it into a 5-minute song. I mean, we still don't write short songs. I mean, none of our songs really are under 4 or 5 minutes, you know. But there was time to be a little more concise and to try to concentrate a little more on the feel of the song more than the technical aspect, which I think is ultimately the most important thing about songwriting, is feel. It sure helps to have good chops and to be able to play real well and to know all those notes, but the ultimate thing that someone listens to is the feel of a song. I mean, that's really the emotional aspect of it. And that's one thing we concentrated on with this album, and it's important to know.
A Monday warrior, mean stride. Today's Tom Sawyer, mean pride.
When we come back, Neil Peart talks about satisfaction and survival.
Star is that been with you for a long time?
Yeah, since 2012.
Oh, really?
That was part of the graphics for the album, and we liked it. It seemed to suit us. Its statement seemed to suit us, so we adopted it.
What is its statement?
Naked men. No. Our statement, I don't know. I can't remember. I think it's really good, whatever it is.
I think it's really good, too.
I think it's really great. I think it has something to do with baseball.
Probably has to do with Fernando Valenzuela. How about solo projects? It seems that a lot of members of a lot of bands feel an overwhelming need to go out and do something on their own. You've been playing with Geddy and Alex for 7 years now, and no one's done any solo projects. Do you ever feel frustrated or held back by the group?
No, that's where we're fortunate. I don't think there are that many other groups that have the kind of freedom that we have in our music, in that there aren't any preconceived ideas of what Rush is. So if one of us wants to get into a particular style of music, there is room. If Alex wants to do some work in classical guitar, which he's very, very fond of, there's no problem in working classical guitar pieces into our music, because, you know, everything fits as far as we're concerned. And Geddy and I, as fans, are interested in some bands like Brand X and like Bill Bruford and so on. So when we want to get involved in complex rhythm section things and stuff like that, there's plenty of room in our band for any kinds of output, you know. It just doesn't matter what it is stylistically, as long as it does excite us in some way or another. So consequently, there's no hidden reserves of material that any of us have. There are no songs that we've written and never used. Everything that we write, if it's good, gets used. So there's a solo album would just have to be, for any of the three of us, this would be true, I think, if we did make a solo album, but it would just be to do something really crazy, you know, to do something really off the wall. Because any genuine ambitions that we have can be and have been realized in this band.
Rush, Off the Record with Mary Turner, has been brought to you by Budweiser. For all you do, this Bud's for you. And the U.S. Navy. Navy, it's not just a job, it's an adventure. This special program was written and produced by Marcia Richeson, with production and engineering by Ron Harris. Off the Record with Mary Turner is a presentation of Westwood One. Executive producer, Norm Pattis.
All right.
Thank
Rush.
You, Norm.
Thank you, Norm. Rush, Off the Record, sponsored by Finders Lounge and Island Water Sports. And now...